Welcome to QI for a show all about numbers. Tonight we will cross the divide and go forth and multiply. And in addition, we will subtract lots of points from Alan. So, let's meet our four fine figures, the rational Colin Lane.
Oh, thank you.
The complex Sarah Millican. The imaginary Noel Fielding. And the extremely random Alan Davis. So, if they would like to grab my attention, they can count on their buzzers, and Colin goes...
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Sarah goes...
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Ah, that's very good. Noel goes...
2, 4, 6, 8.
And Alan goes... Here is question one. Which is the loneliest number?
3, 4, 5.
Yes.
1?
No. It's the obvious one, but it's not that one.
So maybe 2 is the loneliest number because it's next to the one that gets talked about the most.
And do you know what? I would make that entirely a correct answer if it wasn't so horribly wrong. No.
3 is the magic number.
3 is the magic number. Well, I don't know, I've never tried, but so they say.
See, I was going to say 2 as well, but because I just thought it depends on what your marriage is like.
Yeah.
Is it a 13? Because it's quite unlucky, so the other numbers don't want to go near it.
OK, so it is an unpopular number.
Naught.
No, it's quite a high number. So there's a mathematician
100.
Called... Yeah, you're heading in the right
14.
Direction.
14. 200.
No, we're not going to play this high.
101.
72.
110.
Yes!
110?
It's 110! Alan gets the point. So there's a mathematician called Alex Belos, and he wanted to find the world's favourite number. So he asked a lot of people, and 30,023 people responded, and the lowest whole number that nobody chose was 110. It was everybody's least favourite number. So QI has adopted it as our favourite number.
Yeah.
Very, very lukewarm round of applause. You prefer number 7, don't you?
Well, why might you prefer number 7? That's a really interesting thing.
Is it the lucky number?
It's the world's favourite number.
Oh.
That is the one that Alex Belos discovered most people prefer. And in fact, there was a national lottery draw which rather bore this out. The 23rd of March 2016, 5 of the 6 numbers were multiples of 7, OK? So there was 7, 14, 21, 35 and 42, and the other one was 41. And so many people chose them, you got more money for matching 4 numbers than you did for matching 5. So 4 numbers, you got £51, and 5 right, you got £15. Anyway, have a look at these different numbers. So number 1, anybody know what that one is right there in the middle? The hieroglyph.
I'm not good on hieroglyphics. Pass.
So what were you saying, Colin? You were making a noise. You were just making a noise.
I was just making a noise.
What was the noise?
Yes.
Yeah, so that's... weirdly, it's quite close to the correct answer.
Yes.
It's a man holding his hands up, and he's most likely called either her or her. The thing is, there are no vowels in hieroglyphs, so we don't really know how it's pronounced, but it's going to be some kind of vowel-y H sound. And he represents a million for the Egyptians.
Huh?
I think he's just going like, I have no idea how many.
I think he's lost his keys. Someone went, do you know where your keys are? He went, I don't know. They're on your elbows, mate.
Let's have a look at the other ones that we've got other than our Egyptian. So the eye, anybody know what the eye is? Another pictogram?
For 5. Mm-hmm. That's 4, 3. Minus 1.
Mm-hmm. 1, 0. 2.
Yeah. 0.
0.
0.
0. Very good.
0.
It's like I'm working you today. It's the Mayan number 0. They had the concept of 0 by about 30 BC, at which time the Romans and the Greeks didn't bother with it.
Didn't have a number 0.
The Greeks.
Why is it eye-shaped? It looks like the eye's got prison bars over it.
It does.
Like they've outlawed looking.
No, the Greeks didn't bother with it because maths was more geometry for them, so the 0 didn't make any sense. In fact, we don't get the 0 in Europe until about the 13th century. Before that, couldn't be asked.
Couldn't be asked.
let's have another look. OK, number three there. 2^74,207,281 - 1.
Is it going to be the highest prime number or something?
It is. Oh. The largest prime... You're on a...
You are kidding me.
It's a Mersenne prime. It is the largest one they've ever discovered. It contains 220,338,618 digits in total. It's basically 2 × 2 × 2 × 2, 74 million times, wow, minus one.
That's my lucky number.
But it's impossible to believe with these things, isn't it, that it's not divisible by anything at all.
Oh, well, that's...
It's
that's
sort of how, absolutely mind-boggling.
Mind-blowing, isn't it, that that's a prime number. So the next one, number four there, 8,085,000,000. Any thoughts what that might be? It's a huge number, isn't
Bacteria
it?
Bacteria on your person.
Oh, gross me out.
Bacteria within your person. Oh. Bacteria trying to get out of your person.
I've honestly never felt so filthy. No, so if you were to write out all the numbers from 1 to 10 billion in words and organise them into alphabetical order, this is the very first one that would be an odd number. And that is because 8 is the very first number alphabetically, right? It begins with E. Also, all the numbers beginning with 8 have to come before the next number, which would be 11. Okay, so it goes 8, 8 billion, 8 billion and 8, 8 billion and 18, 8 billion and 80, 8 billion and 88, 8 billion and 85. So it's the very first one that is an odd
number. Okay, would it be a problem if you just explain that again?
Did you wish to take the news with you to Australia?
Look what I brought back from England, this amazing piece of information that I still don't understand.
I'm trying to work out a face that I can do that would be as if I did understand that.
Let's look back at the ones that we've got left in our number cloud. 142,857. If I tell you it's a cyclic number, does that mean anything to you?
No, is it to do with bicycles?
Oh, I like that. How many bicycles in Paris, that kind of thing. Yeah, no. So if you take this number and you multiply it by any number between 1 and 6, the answer will always be an anagram of the original number. So it'll just keep all those numbers. So look there, times 2 times 3 times 4.
Good noise.
Yeah.
Ooh.
And then...
We don't understand, but we're going to make... This is the beginnings of subjugation. This number is an anagram of the other numbers. Oh, number.
Let's have a look at the number 43. Anybody know about the number 43?
What I say my age is.
No, just joking.
are you
older or younger?
I'm older, yes.
See, I was being polite.
Yes, thank you.
Boys don't mind about their age. Do they? Do boys mind about their age?
Oh, they pretend that they... Oh, you're shaking your head.
I don't mind about my age.
I don't mind about mine. So
I'm 38 and proud.
Well, I've no idea. A year older than me. So, it's a Frobenius number. Not helping, am I?
No.
They didn't even give you a... Ooh. It's a...
So, I'm going to explain it in terms of McDonald's, OK?
OK.
So, this is a mathematical problem posed by a German called Ferdinand Frobenius in the early 20th century. Let's say it's chicken McNuggets, OK? They are only sold in multiples of 6, 9... and 20, OK? And 43 is the largest number of McNuggets it's impossible to buy. So you could get 41, because you could have 20 and 9 and 6 and 6. You could have 42, because you could have 4 lots of 9 and a 6. You could have 44, because you could have 4 lots of 6 and a 20. You cannot buy 43 McNuggets. I...
Not even...
You'd have to throw some away.
Right.
Not even if you know Ronald McDonald.
No. How did the Danish government convince its citizens to multiply? This is one of my randy scandies.
You mean actually...
I do mean that.
Were there financial incentives?
There were incentives.
We all need incentives anyway, don't we?
What, to procreate?
Mm. Yeah. Or just, you know, the bit before that as well.
Right. I'm fine, but OK.
Incentivize me!
So I can narrow it down. It's actually a place called Tisted, which is in Jutland, so the mainland, the bit that sticks up from Germany. So what happened in 2015, the local authorities were going to close down the local school, and everybody was very upset in the local area. So they struck a deal that the people would procreate as much as possible if they kept the school and the leisure facilities open. Nothing says, I'm bringing sexy back like a council memo.
Did they all have to have kids?
Well, as many as possible, so they were encouraged to have kids. I have to say, it's a lovely place, Tisa. Not a lot to do. Number three on their own website of things to do in the area is visit the candle shop.
Sexy candles for around the bath.
Yeah. There's been lots of times before Britain has had its own panics about falling populations because of the war and contraception and so on. So, in 1921, the Daily Express ran a competition to find Britain's largest family, and the News of the World offered a free tea tray to any mother. Any mother who gave birth to her 10th child. Don't want your bloody tea tray, I'll take your head off with it. And the French still give medals for having large families. That's still a thing, the Médaille de la Famille Française. How many kids for bronze? What do you reckon?
Six.
Yeah. 4 to 5. Silver, you get 6 to 7. Gold, 8+.
I thought you said 45 for a second.
There's so much wrong with that picture. I can't begin.
Go on.
Why are they creating a human bench for their two children?
Yeah, that is worrying.
Have they glued their heads together? Maybe they're ventriloquists and that's how they hold their children. Just used to holding people like that.
Now, here's something nice. Cake. So you've each got a cake and a knife. And here is the challenge, OK? I want you to cut two pieces of exactly equal size. You can use three cuts to do it, but in such a way that the cake is still moist for you to have some more tomorrow. What would be the best way of cutting it?
Could the cake stay moist in my tummy? Because then you just half it.
Yes, you could just half it. No, so the idea is that there is cake for tomorrow. Right. So we're going to start with Alan and Colin first. What is your...
Well, my theory...
Yes?
..is that we cut through the middle.
Okay.
So it's going to be difficult, but we're going to do it.
Right.
And then we take the top off.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then and we eat the bottom bit.
You're going to eat the whole of the bottom bit, is
yeah.
that?
Yeah.
But that's quite a large piece of cake, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah. We're two men in our 30s. We love cake. Take the top off.
Yeah.
Carl's going to remove the bottom of the cake.
Right.
And then put the top back down again. That's right. Moist for tomorrow.
Right.
And then we cut this, paste that there.
Yeah.
We cut this completely in half
right.
like that. Two equal pieces.
Wow, that's very good. do you think anybody who likes the filling is going to be mildly disappointed?
That's right.
So let's go over to.
I think I've got an idea.
No, do it with the cake. Yeah.
I'm just going to draw it first.
Oh, fine. Okay.
Is
so,
that okay?
Yes, darling. You can do what you like.
Yeah. What if we cut it like in a way that we could back together?
I was thinking that.
Yeah.
Where we cut like a bit out of it and a bit out of it and then just.
Yeah. Just. That'd be better, wouldn't it? Than cutting.
Do you want to do it?
I mean, that was a shambles. Right? What they did.
Smushing doesn't sound good.
But I reckon we have to do this first.
Do you think?
Yeah, go on. It's good.
Okay, go for it, Sarah.
Okay, so. Oh, it's tough.
Yeah, so no, delicious is what you're looking for.
And
Do you just draw on Pac-Man? That doesn't make any sense.
So take out your pieces.
These are our pieces.
Noel, were you calling us a shambles? Is that what you were saying?
There you go.
So there is a mathematical way of doing it. There was a man called Francis Galton. He's an extraordinary fellow. He was an explorer. He was the very first person to come up with the idea of a weather map. And he also was slightly obsessed with the idea of sharing a Christmas cake with his wife in an even manner. So what he did was he wrote a rather long treatise on the subject, which he sent to Nature magazine. You're absolutely heading in the right direction. So what you do is you cut right down the middle like this, and then you pull out the entire centre piece.
That was it.
That's only two cuts, though.
Oh, wait, I haven't finished.
Okay.
So you pull out the whole thing like
then
this, and then you cut that one in half.
Yeah.
So then you have two pieces.
Oh, we were nearly there.
Oh, you were very nearly there. You have two pieces of cake like that, and then you simply push the cake back together.
It's about and it will stay.
How you can halve your cake and eat it. But now to a question about wrong numbers. Where's the worst place in the world for nuisance calls?
That was a great picture.
Do you not think you thought more carefully about making a phone call when you had to dial it one number at a time? You just didn't.
Oh, if you had to dial someone who had lots of eights and nines in it, yeah, sometimes you wouldn't bother.
Just can't be asked.
I mean, are we looking for a country?
We are looking
for a
place.
Wouldn't it be the country with the most people in?
No, ironically, the place with the fewest telephones for a short while. So it is, in fact, the Pacific island of Niue. It looks fab, doesn't it?
Mm.
Niue. Yep. So in the early 90s, people were constantly woken up by heavy breathers because the country was the home of an extremely lucrative sex line business and people often used to dial the wrong number. There were only 387 telephones on the island, and the phone numbers only had four digits, so people were often misdialing.
So this is people ringing the wrong number and expecting a sex line?
Yes.
So they, if they're already heavy breathing, they've started already? I didn't know this.
Maybe it was just a line, a helpline for asthma, people with asthma. Nothing sexual. That guy's trying to ring nine people at the same time. That's not going to work.
So they had a terrible time because there were people constantly getting wrong numbers. And Belgium is another country that ran sex lines for quite a while. And when they were banned, this is the most brilliant thing, they started a new thing, which was cookery lines with recipes read in the most sexual way possible. They used to read out sexy recipes.
What's a sexy recipe?
Toad in the hole.
Toad in the hole. Can't think of anything more exciting, I think.
That's quite fancy, a toad in the hole. Last time I had that, I had a football under my arm and a catapult in my pocket. So, 2 weeks ago.
So here's the thing, we're going to make our own nuisance call this evening. There is a number that anybody can ring in Sweden, and it's a scheme set up by the country's tourism authority to celebrate 250 years of free speech in Sweden, and it's called Ring a Random Swede, OK? It's a genuine random thing. We have no idea who we're going to get. We've already pre-selected a question from a member of the audience, and the question is, why do you eat rotten fish?
Does anybody speak Swedish?
Here's the marvellous thing about Scandinavians is that their English is really coming along.
OK.
The marvellous sound department are going to put the call through now, and I obviously will have to explain what it is that we're doing to this person.
Calling Sweden. You will soon be connected to a random Swede somewhere in Sweden. This call may be recorded. A lot of people are calling Sweden right now.
Oh, hello.
Hello.
Hi. My name is Sandy. I'm ringing from London. Who's that?
This is Robin in South Sweden.
Robin! Oh, hi. You're my random Swede that I'm ringing.
Is it
your first phone call from an English person?
It's my first call overall, actually.
Oh! This is kind of exciting, Robin, because I'm ringing you from a live television studio in London. So you're on the BBC right now. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay. So I tell you what, we'll have a round of applause from our audience. Maybe you can hear that.
Brilliant.
So what do you do, Robin?
I'm shopping some groceries.
Okay. Are you actually in the shop?
Yeah.
Okay. So we have a question from our audience, and you may be buying this now. What do I know? Why do Swedish people eat rotten fish? Is the question we want to ask you.
Yeah, most of us also want to know this question. So please call back again.
It was lovely to speak to you,
Robin. Yeah.
Thank you.
His English was pretty good.
That English coming along, wasn't
yeah,
it?
It's yeah, it's coming along. Yeah.
You'll
coming
never along. Meet an unfriendly Swede, that's
no,
my view.
Darling. That's because they're marvellous. Usually drunk. It's a Danish-Swedish thing. Right, let's play. How many people in the audience? Each of my panellists has got a coloured card, OK? And the audience also has coloured cards, and I'm going to get them to stand up, and I want you to tell me which item on this list relates to the number of people who are standing. So we're going to start with Colin. What colour is your card, Colin?
Blue.
Blue. So could all the blue card people stand up, please? What do you reckon, Colin? How many people do you think that is?
It's about
180, 200
people.
It's 230 people standing. And it took 230 people to do one of these five things.
Selfie fatalities in 2014.
It is not. It is something a bit more substantial.
Built the Eiffel Tower.
Built the Eiffel Tower is absolutely right. Built by 230 people in 2 years. Thank you. As you can see, back down again. And we will come to Sarah. What colour is your card?
I have red.
So could I have the red card standing, please? How many do you think that might be?
Oh, 100, maybe?
69.
Oh,
so
OK.
Have a look at the list. What do you reckon?
I think maybe the selfie fatalities.
We keep going for that one. It isn't that. It is the world record number of children born to a single mother.
No way!
All of you are now related, which is rather exciting. It is a woman called Valentina Vasilyev. She had 16 pairs of twins. She had 7 sets of triplets, 4 sets of quadruplets in 40 years between 1725 and 1765. In total, 27 births. Her husband, Fyodor Vasilyev, went on to have a further 18 children with his second wife.
So he left her?
I think she died. I think she died. It's unbelievable, isn't it?
But the way she was having children was someone was unscrewing her and they were just getting
Let's have a look at yours, Noel. What colour is your card? A white one. Let's have all the white cards stand, please. How many people do you reckon that is?
50.
49, you're almost exactly right. And what does that represent?
Selfie fatalities.
Maybe.
Everybody's gone for the selfie fatalities. What do you reckon?
QI. Contestants.
You should have gone for the selfie fatalities. very sadly, in 2014, died taking a selfie. 16 oh. came from a fall, 4 from a gunshot, 1 from an animal. I don't know what the story is. I've no idea. The most common place, apparently, to die taking a selfie is in India, followed by Russia. So, I tell you what, Alan, why did you get the whole audience to stand up? Let's have a...
Everyone, please rise.
There we are. So, that is Ooh. The entire audience.
Oh, I've heard that noise before.
Turn you back for 2 seconds.
So 625 people is the QI audience. I can tell you it represents people who died in a certain way. They didn't die together. It was 625 individual incidents.
Domestic accident?
It's an accident was in the home, but...
coming to panel shows?
The word coming is going to be most...
Getting jiggy.
It is the number of people in 2014 who died from autoerotic asphyxiation.
Sit down, you dirty bastard. I'm sorry, I'm confused. I thought for a moment that you were all autoerotics.
And that's how to explain the dangers of autoerotic asphyxiation using our studio audience. Which talk of hard sums brings us to the insoluble equation that is general ignorance. So fingers on buzzers, please. In terms of numbers, which is the most common vertebrate in the world? ABC. Oh, Alan.
Humans. we haven't you like the klaxon? We'll get some more, we'll get some more.
7 billion humans. I mean, I can tell you already there are more chickens than there are.
Chickens.
Chickens.
It's not rats.
No, it's not rats.
I have got it.
Yes.
People who died of autoasphyxiation.
It's a fish.
Fish.
It's a fish called the bristle mouth. and it's tiny. It is smaller than your finger, but if it opens its mouth that wide, it's got these incredible needle-like teeth. It's an amazing fish. It glows, and it eats even smaller creatures, which you can see they're called copepods, but they're not vertebrates. But this is the largest number of vertebrates in the world. They live in the sea between half a mile and 3 miles down. And until the 21st century, so they get the very fine dredging nets, we didn't really know how many there were. The estimate now is that there are as many as a dozen per square metre of ocean surface, which is incredible.
And they disguise themselves as diagrams.
They do. The most common animal in the world is an invertebrate. It's a nematode worm. 4 out of 5 of all animals is a nematode.
Anything that comes at you like that without any eyes...
That's why some of us made the life choices we did. The word noon comes from the word nun, which meant nine. So with that in mind, if you had to meet a 9th century nun at noon, what time would you noodle off to the nunnery?
Noon means nun, which came from nine. You're meeting the
nun
at
what time
nine.
Would you meet if you're meeting the nun at noon?
12.
Nine.
Yeah.
There isn't a nun.
I like that as a nun.
Anyone else want to have a go?
Call them instead.
Until the mid-12th century, the word noon meant 3 o'clock in the afternoon.
Oh, bollocks.
You were so winning as well. Destroyed your score.
It goes back to old Christian prayer times. So it used to be that the day began at 6 a.m., so that was known as the prime or the first hour. And then you have tierce, so the third hour, that would be 9 a.m. today. None is the ninth hour.
That guy in the orange has got my haircut. He's praying for a new one. Please, I don't want to be in cabaret anymore.
Until the Middle Ages, noon was 3 p.m. And all this talk of time makes me realise it must be time for the scores. In last place, with minus 41, is Alan. It should be saying next, but we're going to skip over that, and we're going to put in third place Colin with minus 9. And in second place, Noel with 1 point. So, Sarah actually got minus 26, but I was supposed to do a gig for Sarah and I let her down by becoming the new host of QI and I couldn't do it. So this week's winner to make up for it is Sarah. Sarah, Noel, Colin, Alan and me, and I leave you with this number-related Neolithic newspaper nugget from the Eastern Evening News. When two men stole 6 sheep from a farm at Munford, they found they could only get 5 of them into the back of their van. So the other one had to sit in the cab between the two men. But the men had to pass through Watton on their way home. Fearing that the sheep sitting in the cab might be conspicuous, they disguised it by putting a Trilby hat on its head.